Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We are switching today from coronavirus to another mainstream story which is going under the radar right now. Although I will mention coronavirus in the end, although in a more interesting context. So what is the big story that I said is slipping under the radar? That is the execution of another of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman's assassins. This is Captain Abdul Majid, who was arrested in Dhaka just the other day. Looks like he told Bangladeshi authorities that he had been hiding in India in Kolkata for a long time, and then quickly he was executed because he was carrying a death sentence on his head since 2009, had been a fugitive since then. Now, besides the fact that looks too pat, to which I will come later, let's reconstruct for you what happened. Because these are events of 15th August 1975, Indian Independence Day 1975. The events took place in Dhaka, essentially at the Dhanmandi residence of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, but also the army headquarters, couple of other places, and couple of other residences in the better of parts of or what you might call the Latians equivalent of Dhaka. Now, let me take you back before I reconstruct the events for you. Let me take you back to the times. 1975 was a long time back. Most of you were not born in 1975. It was 45 years back. I was just about 18 at that point. Now, go to the summer of 1975. By that time, economic situation in India and political situation in India is very unstable. Our inflation is at 30% because India is a post-war economy. In fact, the entire subcontinent is a post-war economy. It's a post-1971 war economy, but it's also an economy that is reeling under the oil shock, because 1973, the Yom Kippur War came, and that's when the oil-producing countries combined and cartelized and decided to up the oil prices. So these very poor countries, which had just faced war, were reeling from that. India had political instability also. Mrs. Gandhi had been unseated by the Allahabad High Court. She had a very uneasy stay from Supreme Court. Bhutto in Pakistan had his own struggles. He had to deal with a country which had broken up. So everything was up in the air. This is also a period when Cold War was at its peak all over the world. And remember, as we come into 1975, we are still also under the influence of the assassination in Chile, faraway Chile, of popular President Salvador Allende and his replacement by Pinochet. That was proven to be a CIA operation. And that led many of these other leaders, particularly those who were seen to be not pro-American and who were seen to be of the left or socialists, to fear that the same specter now hung on their heads as well. In fact, Indira Gandhi used that in the discourse at that point as a piece of evidence to say, look, there are big powers who are targeting us. Now, I now take you to June of 1975. June 14 of 1975. By this time, situation in Bangladesh had become really bad because Bangladesh had really been destroyed by Pakistani army by the occupation. Nearly a crore of its population at that point, which must have been more than 10%, maybe 15% of its population, had gone as refugees to India. They were coming back. The country had been devastated. Lots of people were killed. Children were killed. Hundreds of thousands of women were raped. This was truly a very poor country, very poor part of a very poor country that was Pakistan, and then suffered greatly during that war. Now, that country had its own struggles, and the Awami League, which came to power because Sheikh Mujibur Rahman was the founder and chief of Awami League, that was trying to put things together. Awami League was a left-wing socialist party, but a left-wing socialist party, not really a dictatorial party. Now, another left-wing element of Awami League broke away and they converted themselves into some kind of a insurgent movement. These were younger people. So these younger people then started some kind of activity, some kind of insurgent activity against the Mujib government. Now, this group was called Gono Bahini. Gono means people in Bengali. So Gono Bahini, they were carrying out this insurgent activity. Now Sheikh Mujib got more hassled, more panicky, and there was a sense of emergency in the country. So think about it. 14th of June 1975, Bangladesh under Sheikh Mujibur Rahman imposed what could be called its own version of the emergency. Indian emergency came a fortnight later. And how did this happen? Sheikh Mujib's government passed the Fourth Amendment. He was the president then. Fourth Amendment or inserted Article 178 to the Constitution. This was June 7, I apologize, not June 14. So Indian emergency came 3 weeks later. June 7, he set up a new national party called Baksal, that is Bangladesh Krishak Shramik Awami League. So Awami League morphed into Baksal, but it abolished all other political parties and took away all press freedom, etc., etc. So this became like a communist party rule in a classical communist country, much on the East European format. That led to problems, and this government itself was also no perfect government. There were many excesses committed under this government, and disaffection was rising in the country. That is the time when a bunch of Bangladesh army officers got together and decided to do something about it. Now the names I will mention to you, major, these are all majors. That's why it was called the coup of the majors at that point. Major Syed Fakhtur, Syed Farooq Rahman, Khandakar Abdul Rashid, Shariful Haq Dalim, Moinuddin Ahmad, E.K. Moinuddin Ahmad, there were two of them, Bazlul Huda, SHMB, Noor Chaudhry, they all got together and they started talking and saying, look, Bangladesh can't carry on like this, we'll be destroyed, if at all we'll become slaves of India, so we have to do something about it. So they went to Major General Ziaur Rahman then, he wasn't the chief. He was number two in the army and said, we need to do something about it. Looks like they had his blessings and they organized this coup and assassination against Sheikh Mujib and his family. Now, what happened on the day of the assassination? They chose on the 12th of August was Colonel Major Farooq's wedding anniversary. He had a party at his home. As the wedding anniversary party ended around 12:30 a.m., they decided that the date of the coup and the assassinations was going to be the 15th. In fact, they were not quite sure they were going to assassinate Mujibur Rahman. Their idea was, we'll go there, we will ask him to abrogate all the changes he had made to the constitution, resign, offer himself for arrest, we'll take him to the cantonment and keep him there. We need not kill him. But if he refuses to resign and offer himself for arrest, we should be open to assassinating him. And as these things end, they always end with the worst case scenario. So they ended up assassinating him. So what happened that day on the 15th? These army officers, all majors, one odd colonel, several captains, couple of risaldars, the key elements of these came from the armored corps, from 1st Armored Division, the Bengal Lancers Regiment, an old famous armor cavalry regiment of Bangladesh Army. They got together and broke themselves, divided themselves into four groups. One group went to Sheikh Mujib's house. One group, the larger group, went out to see if troops loyal to Sheikh Mujib were going to fight back. A regiment of the artillery was summoned to direct fire at the headquarters of the army unit that was personally loyal to Sheikh Mujib in case he acted funny. Another group headed the tank corps, so there were tanks available there. A third group went to another brother-in-law's, Sheikh Mujib's brother-in-law's house, and another one went to his nephew's house. And then you see what happened. Now, Sheikh Kamal, that is Sheikh Mujib's son, he was killed at the reception area on the ground floor of his house. So that was done very quickly. Number two, when Sheikh Mujib saw this, he summoned his chief of military intelligence, Colonel Jamiluddin, to come and restore order. So he came and he shouted at these officers not to do this. They shot him. So he was the next one dead. Then they went up, they killed Sheikh Mujib's wife, that is Sheikh Fazilatunisa Mujib. They killed his younger brother, Sheikh Nasir. They killed his younger son, Sheikh Jamil, the first one they had killed at the reception area, Sheikh Kamal. Sheikh Jamal they killed later. Sheikh Mujib refused to surrender and withdraw his orders and abdicate and offer himself for arrest. So he was shot also. Sheikh Mujib's youngest son, Sheikh Russell, if I remember correctly, he was a child. If I remember correctly, he was just about 10 or something. He was killed. Sheikh Mujib's two daughters-in-law were also killed. And so were the families of his brothers and many guards. Many of them had hidden themselves inside the toilets. So these guys broke into the toilets and killed them all. Now, two other groups went to other areas. One went to the house of Sheikh Mujib's nephew, Sheikh Fazlul Haq Mani, who was also an Awami League office bearer. They killed him and his pregnant wife, Arzu Moni, if I remember correctly. Then another group went to the house of Abdul Rab Sarniabat, who was a brother-in-law of Sheikh Mujib. That group killed him and several members of his family. So basically the idea was that nobody around Sheikh Mujib should survive. It does seem that this captain Abdul Majed, who's just been executed, he was in the group that went to Abdul Rab Sarniabat's house, but he was essential to the main conspiracy because he's the one who not only was a kingpin, but who had also taken out weapons from the Bengal Lancers armory and later had publicly boasted that he was responsible. In fact, he had never denied the fact that he was responsible for the assassination of Sheikh Mujib. It's just that he was among those many people who were hiding. Of the 20 allegedly involved then and put to trial, 15 were convicted by the trial court. The High Court acquitted 5 of them. The Supreme Court changed that decision. So, Supreme Court convicted 12, they let 3 get away. Many of these went into exile. In fact, when the new government came in after Sheikh Mujib's death, and I will tell you a little bit, it's very complicated about what happened. They first of all passed an indemnity ordinance, which said that none of these officers, they all had indemnity for what they had done earlier. So, within months of the assassination, the successor president, Khondakar Mushtaq Ahmad, he issued an indemnity ordinance which later Ziaur Rahman's government ratified. So these people were safe till then. They were given foreign postings, sent to Bangladesh missions here and there. Many of them settled overseas, some never surfaced. But later, as trial after trial, as it happens in the subcontinent, date after date after date, and in many changes took place in Bangladesh in 1996, Sheikh Hasina came back and she repealed the earlier indemnity law that the martial law dictators had passed. Once that happened, trial started. In 2010, January, 5 of these convicts were executed and the government was searching for the rest of them. So this Abdul Majed is from among the rest of them. So that is the story of the assassination. Then what happens after assassination? Bangladesh, in fact, has had a much tougher history of military coups and takeovers and toppling of governments than Pakistan, because Pakistan is a strange country. It's a unique country in the world where every coup has been peaceful. It's as if everybody is waiting for a coup. Nobody needs to be assassinated at the time of the coup. Later, the guy you replace in a coup will always be either jailed, exiled, assassinated, or all three. But nobody is to fire a bullet in Pakistan to take over. In this case, these people took over after killing Mujibur Rahman his family. Not just that, four key leaders of his party were also arrested and locked up in jail immediately. As that happened, you knew that Awami League was left with no leadership. And to leave nothing to chance, after killing Sheikh Mujib's entire family, they also took Tajuddin Ahmad, former Prime Minister, Mansoor Ali, also former Prime Minister, former Vice President Sayyid Nazrul Islam, former Home Minister Qamaruzzaman, all of them were arrested and they were locked up in jail. Later, on 3rd of November, they were assassinated inside the jail. In that also, this Abdul Majid was supposedly involved. He was given a life sentence for those murders as well. So, not a nice guy at all. Now, what happened after Mujib died? After Mujib died, one of these officers, as we told you, has the name Khandakar something. Now, he had a close relation, Khandakar Mushtaq Ahmad, who was then Commerce Minister. And he said that once Sheikh Mujib is out of the way, we will make him in charge of the administration. So, Khandakar Mushtaq Ahmad was made in charge of the administration. But there were other people in Bangladesh, they were patriots, and these were people who had fought in the freedom movement, who did not like this. And one of them was a Brigadier Khalid Musharraf. The Brigadier Khalid Musharraf was one of the heroes of the 1971 Mukti Bahini freedom movement. He had been among the most decorated soldiers on the Bangladeshi side at that point. He was also a decent soldier. He was also a loyalist of the Mujib family, and he did not like what was going on. He was then a Brigadier General Staff in the Army headquarters. So he did go to Zia and said, look, the entire army's system has been upset. These officers were involved in Mujib's assassination. You do something about them. Zia did nothing, obviously, because Zia was hand in glove with them. And the new president, one of the first things he did was to then elevate Zia as the army chief, although Zia was number one. This is Ziaur Rahman. He was number two, so he was made the chief of army staff. So out of frustration and around time on the 3rd, these other Awami League leaders were assassinated in the jail. Brigadier Khalid carried out a little coup of his own, removed Khandakar Mushtaq Ahmad and took over power. He did not declare himself anything. He took over power. He was in charge of the country, but it lasted only 4 days. His idea was not to continue to be in power. His idea was to maybe take the help of a good general or somebody to restore some semblance of order in Bangladesh and to bring in a regular, legitimate government. But he wasn't allowed to be, because for General Ziaur Rahman, stakes were very high. So, within 4 days, November 7, he had gone along with a couple of other friends of his, also army officers, to the house of yet another army officer, a close friend of theirs. They were assassinated there and they were killed. So this was the cycle of assassinations, after which Ziaur Rahman took over. So as I had said to you in Cut The Clutter, episode 212, there was a period now when India had Zias on both sides. Ziaul Haq from 1978 onwards in Pakistan, and now Ziaur Rahman in Bangladesh already. So India had these two generals in charge of the two countries that had come out as a result of Pakistan's vivisection, dismemberment, and it looked like India had a double problem, and all the gains of the war in over Bangladesh had now been frittered away. Mrs. Gandhi always saw it as a conspiracy, as the part of a larger conspiracy, that, and she obviously blamed the Americans for it, because this was then the peak of the Cold War, and the Americans and the CIA were then working together with many other forces and local elements to try and bring down the regimes or governments they did not like. In fact, there is a book by Lawrence Lifschultz on that period, or Laurie Lifschultz as he's called, Bangladesh, the Unfinished Revolution, in which he hints, more than hints, he insinuates quite strongly that CIA was involved in Mujib's assassination. So Mrs. Gandhi, for a long time, and her supporters said that, look, this was going to happen to her also. And that's why she had to impose the emergency. I mean, all of us think, most of us think it was a fake excuse. And the Congress party itself has stopped defending it for a very long time now. So whatever it was, a period of instability began. Ziaur Rahman came in, 81. He was also assassinated. So in fact, his wife, Khalida Zia, also joined politics. Now, when the kid destroyed Mujibur Rahman's family, the idea was to kill every member of his family, including a child, but, or many children in the family. But what they could not help was the fact that two of his daughters survived because they were in West Germany. Sheikh Hasina was among them. So they came back to Delhi and sought refuge in Delhi. So Sheikh Hasina also went back and built her father's politics. Khalida Zia built politics after her assassinated husband. So one widow and one daughter of an assassinated, not just father, but also mother, uncles, brothers, everybody, sisters-in-law, nephews, nieces, they got together and they in a way collaborated to get rid of the dictatorship in Bangladesh. It so happens now that willy-nilly, Bangladesh is back to having a kind of dictatorship, although it's an elected dictatorship. It's the closest you can get to a dictatorship after having been elected through the ballot. That is Sheikh Hasina's government. So this, the execution of this man closes one more chapter in that big epic beginning in 1975. It's not over yet, because a few people are still here and there. Several of the old Jamaat-e-Islami people who were involved, convicted, charged with carrying out massive massacres and atrocities during 1971 are also hiding here and there. A couple of them in Pakistan. I think it's in the course of time, reckoning will catch up with them also. So this, I thought, was a very important thing to talk about today, and also to take you back to a very tumultuous period in the subcontinent's history. And I said I will mention coronavirus in the passing. So Bill Maher, who is an American comedian, he has said something, and I'll give you a link of our story on what he has said with the description today. He has said that it's completely wrong to say that calling coronavirus the Chinese virus is racist. And he says something that we had said in a Cut The Clutter a few days back, that most viruses are named after the place they came from. Zika virus, Ebola virus, Henta virus, because of Hentan River, West Nile virus. Most bad viruses are known after the place they came from. So why can't you call this the Chinese virus? Now, this has led to a lot of response. Many people say this is absolutely the right thing, and that includes many of the Indian liberals also. This is something on which, in fact, BJP and the Congress both seem to agree. Our former Foreign Secretary, Nirupama Rao, by no means not a liberal, has also found merit in this. But there are also many others in America and elsewhere in the liberal community who are attacking Bill Maher for being racist. But I will tell you something else. And this is just an aside. And I told you I'll talk about Corona, but talk about something slightly different and more interesting. We remember 1918, the flu pandemic around the world that kills tens of millions of people, crores of people, as the Spanish flu. Now, everybody would now think that this originated in Spain, just as this virus originated in Wuhan and China, or Ebola from Congo. But that is not the case with the Spanish flu. 1918 is when the world was at war with itself. That was World War I. Most countries of Europe were involved in World War I. And because they were involved in World War I, they had put strong censorship and controls over the press in their own countries. You're going back to 1918, no social media, no internet, no TV, no nothing. So because the press was controlled, they did not like their press talking about deaths because of the flu, the spread of the flu, because they thought that will demoralize their populations. Spain, on the other hand, was neutral in that war. And because Spain was neutral, its media was relatively free. So while all other European countries around Spain were keeping the news of the spread of the flu down, it was the Spanish media which was talking about it all the time. And in the course of time, because the rest of the world had seen most of the news from Spanish media, this acquired the name of Spanish flu. So these things happen sometimes, and history has its own way of getting even with you. So let us see what happens tomorrow with coronavirus.